Dr. Leigh, it's good to see you.
Hank, it's great to see you too. It's been a while.
Yeah, it has. Since our last discussion, there's been a lot of progress with your work and with your team. High on that list is that you've grown another superstorm in a supercomputer that drops a long-track EF5 in an environment similar to a historic environment that also did the same thing.
That's correct. So about a year ago, you and I had a little conversation on your channel where we talked about my simulation of a 24 May 2011 storm in El Reno, Oklahoma. Now, one of my research goals and the research goals of my team is to not just do this for one storm, but to do this for multiple storms. So for the last year or so, we've been searching around for different environmental conditions to initialize our model with so we can grow some new storms. Dr. Catherine Finley at the University of North Dakota took a sounding. This is the National Weather Service balloon launch data. So anybody can go online right now, go to the 18Z Jackson, Mississippi sounding from 27 April 2011, download that sounding and run it in a cloud model, and it should produce a tornado if you run it at high enough resolution. So we're pretty excited about this. The storm that we have produces a long track EF5 tornado on the virtual ground for at least a half an hour. April 27th, 2011 was the big outbreak in the southeast. There was a F4 tornado in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. There were multiple F4s and F5 tornadoes in this event. From my perspective, what makes the southeast so challenging is the topography. You as a chaser, of course, would agree, I think. It's a difficult region to study because of all the hills and all the trees.
Yeah, you usually get a one shot at those storms. You know, it comes, it flies by you, you get your 5 minutes, if you're lucky, a video, and then you try to catch up to it, but then you have to stop because there's trees in your road, there's cars in your road, there's people in your road.
So we sought out that event because it was such a major event.
Your team has finally had some time to analyze the data.
Yeah.
Or you've had more time.
More time.
You're developing some pretty solid theories on tornado genesis and making some pretty bold statements.
Yes. I continue to make the assertion that you do not need a rear flank downdraft to have a tornado, or at least to maintain a strong tornado. So one of the leading theories of tornado genesis involves a downdraft in the rear flank that triggers a tornado. And you addressed that really well in our first talk. So far as I know, that theory does not extend to the maintenance phase of a tornado. What our theory does not contain is a trigger. We do not have a triggering mechanism that leads to the tornado. What our simulations are showing, and that what's sort of becoming clear, is that the updrafts can be very strong, very close to the ground. And this is something I think that is a relatively new discovery. The amount of stretching that the updraft can do is a lot more than we thought, because the updraft is stronger than we thought near the ground. It's almost as if, when you look at what's going on near the ground, that the storm itself is finding ways to consolidate vorticity. It doesn't matter if it's from the environment or if it's from the cold pool or the storm has generated itself, but it's basically taking all this horizontal vorticity from different areas, it's converging it towards the center, and then it's abruptly tilting it into the vertical. When that horizontal vorticity is tilted into the vertical, it then becomes vertical vorticity, which contributes towards the mesocyclone and maybe even towards the tornado's rotation, because that rotation has to come from somewhere. What we've discovered is, in the vicinity of the SVC, the air pressure is dropping like a rock. When you have very low pressure just above your head, it's going to create a pressure gradient that is going to make the air want to go up, okay? If you create a vacuum, air will go in to fill it. So that's like one of the fundamental forces of nature, and that's the pressure gradient force. So what I'm thinking is going on is the SVC results in a lowering of the pressure. A lowering of the pressure results in a strengthening and a lowering of the updraft base. The strengthening and the lowering of the updraft base results in extreme stretching and tilting of vorticity near the ground, which ultimately results in a tornado. Not only does it result in a tornado, but it helps to maintain the tornado that forms. And again, this theory is not in stone. I would suggest that what explains the clear slot and the big wraparound that occurs prior to tornado genesis, instead of it being a cause of tornado, I think it's an effect of the rapidly lowering pressure in the lower part of the mesocyclone. The air is responding to that drop in pressure such that air that would normally sort of scoot towards the rear and just continue to go ends up getting pulled back inwards, so it gets sucked around this big low pressure region. So perhaps What you're seeing is the pressure drops, then you see the wraparound in the RFD, then the tornado forms. I'm not going to claim to have solved this problem. I don't want to appear like I have. I just have an alternate theory, at least, for the specific type of storm that we're studying that does not involve any downdraft in the rear flank to trigger or to even maintain the storm. I'm arguing that it really has to do with the forward flank, the SVC, and other things.
You know, I'll also throw out that I've been underneath storms with big tornadoes on the ground, and there appeared to be no RFD.
I'm on the back side of this thing, and oddly enough, there's no RFD. This is really weird.
See, and that's more like what ours is going. It's funny, one of the students who was looking at this work, along with my collaborator, Catherine Finley, she said, "Where's the RFD?" It's like an RFU. See, that would be consistent with our type of tornadogenesis regime. You essentially have a parade of vortices coming along the forward flank of the storm. At some point in the storm's evolution, when that pressure drop becomes really intense, everybody just goes towards that location. Convergence just happens, and everything just gets concentrated into one spot.
Going further back in time, it's the pressure drop.
It's the pressure drop. And then the question is, what leads to the pressure drop? And that's why I'm honing in on the SVC, because the SVC is definitely a region of low pressure. So if we can find out what causes the SVC, when do SVCs form, when do they not form, then maybe we can say, well, an SVC has formed in this storm. That might be an indicator that it's going to produce a longer tornado than normal or something. We don't know yet, okay? But I'm hypothesizing why we're focusing on these features is because they might have diagnostic predictability qualities where we can use them to maybe give people a better idea of the kind of storm it's forming. And again, that's really my ultimate goal. If the SVC is real, we find them in nature, then the question is, okay, how do we detect them and how do we use them as a new tool in our toolkit of forecasting to give a better prediction of what that storm is going to do? Can we? I know that some people think the SVC is just along for the ride. Maybe something else is leading to it and it's just getting sucked up and it's just a passive thing. I don't think that's true, but it's up to me to prove that or to show that, and that's what we're working on. So someone like me can only publish my results if I do my due diligence on observational work as well. It's very rare that you'll publish a paper that just talks about the model simulation and doesn't look at the real atmosphere, because what's the point?
With that, what do you say we go look at some of the matches? And I wanted to see what you thought about some of the matches that I have picked out for us.
Sure. All right. Let's do this.
Let's open up comparison number one.
Yes.
So this one is one of my favorites. I think if you don't know anything about supercells, you might see all those lines and stratification, and you might think, like, that doesn't look natural.
Right.
And but a storm chaser will say, oh, yeah, that's kind of the ideal storm you want to see, is you want to see an updraft that has all that wind sculpting. I mean, we just go crazy for that. One of the things that I really like about this comparison that I've done is you've got these extensions, these appendages, at two different layers streaming in from the south into the updraft, and your storm rendered something very similar to that.
This is why I love this collaboration we have, Hank, is that I'm just gobsmacked by how similar these two images look. In the Tuscaloosa storm, or the storm we're calling the Tuscaloosa storm, the new one, you get these cloud bands, and when I animate the storm, you see that sometimes they come and they go.
Yeah, but look at even the wall cloud.
Yes.
There's even a
little tiny little tail.
Yeah.
No, let's go on to the next one.
Okay, so the next one, this was the same atmosphere. After that storm died, another storm popped up to the north. And again, I'm using this just to say, look, here's another storm with all of those wind sculpted striations to show people that, yeah, this is actually common. And we do see that weird looking UFO shaped updraft.
This is really amazing what you've done, Hank. I wanted people to understand this. I mean, you're coming up with stuff that looks really similar. And again, I can even count the layers in the layer cake. You know, you got three of them. I mean, I just have to say, tremendous work. So this says to me that the model that we're using is probably doing a pretty decent job when you can actually create something that looks a lot like Mother Nature. In the simulated storm, you have a very clear tail cloud. You see the similar feature in Hank's image there, and you see striations in the barrel-like mesocyclone, and you can certainly tell that there's rain falling in the forward flank. So very nice comparison.
Awesome. Thank you. Let's move on to number three.
All right, number three. Oh boy, it's all about that tail cloud, isn't it?
Yeah, so on your other storm, we had all different kinds of tail clouds. We had the long streaming tail cloud, and on this one, you just kind of have a nub.
Oh, you have a nub, exactly, but that happens all the time.
It happens all the time, and here's a storm that I got this year in Colorado. I was like, wow, this tail cloud is very similar to the one that I witnessed. So I just want to show that this little nubby wall cloud is actually a very common feature that we see in these storms.
Exactly. And another thing I would say is look at the rain foot in my image, the black thing.
Yeah. Oh, wow. I didn't even notice that. Right. How it's bending into the updraft. Right.
You can sort of point your way to the updraft by the way that right. that rain foot is oriented.
Wow. Good call.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you see it in your image, you see it in mine. So there's another similarity between those two. So excellent, excellent.
Awesome, sweet. And then number four.
Number four. Oh, yeah. Oh, God.
There you go. So this is one of my favorite storms. This was the first tornado of the day. And again, you've got kind of a little tail cloud. You've got these tiers in the updraft in the mesocyclone, you know, in that little vaultish area. And then perspective, the tornado relative is pretty similar spatially.
Man, I gotta tell you, that is just so cool. As a modeler, when I see stuff like this, I just go, wow. Because, you know, I spend a lot of time looking at the stuff on the right, which is like, okay, it looks good, but it's a model. But when I see the stuff you've got, it just, it warms my heart because it means that we're on the right track. And I, as a scientist, you might think I'm crazy to be so conservative about my opinion, but I'm very, very aware of how it's easy to have your own sort of a confirmation bias where you're seeing things and you're focusing on the thing that you think is there already. That happens in science.
So when you've got a dude doing it for you, it's always comforting, right?
It helps. That just means, it just says, look, chances are we're getting this stuff right because Mother Nature is Mother Nature. She's doing what she's doing. The model is essentially the laws of physics as well as we understand them. So this means that when I start to present results, really quantitative results from our work, and I show images like this, you know, it's going to be hard to argue against my theory should at least be plausible because look at Mother Nature and look at the simulation. They're very similar. So one of the things about our simulation is that the tornado condensation funnel doesn't always extend to the ground, and that has to do with the issue with the way we handle the microphysics. In a real tornado, if you get rain in the tornado, it gets spun outwards, it gets centrifuged outwards. Our model doesn't have that physics in it yet, so sometimes our tornado gets filled with rain and that ends up sort of eating away some of the cloud. So sometimes you don't see the condensation funnel all the way to the ground, but rest assured there is a tornado on the ground. And yeah, a tornado itself can be on the ground causing damage and there not be a condensation funnel. That is certainly occurs in nature as well.
Oh yeah, and I can show you plenty of video of that. You know, if there wasn't any dust, you wouldn't even know there was a tornado there.
Exactly. So that happens in our model sometimes, and sometimes it happens for the right reasons, and sometimes it happens because, oh, well, we got to find a way to get that rain to spiral out of the tornado. Again, it's work in progress. And that's true with anything scientific. When you see someone, a scientist, talking about their work, rest assured that, you know, they're not done. It's always work in progress. It's always just keeping the needle pushed towards the direction of understanding and understanding what's going on in the world. But that's a beautiful comparison right there.
Yeah, this is kind of a new storm for you. Your last storm, by the time I had caught wind of it, you had been lecturing about this storm for 2-3 years. And I had a plethora of angles and it was no problem getting all these different results. Really all that I've gotten from you so far is this one rendering. And with that one rendering, I was still able to get a lot of close similarities. So again, in my opinion, that's a supercell.
That's a supercell. I'm of the same opinion, Hank. And as we've talked recently, using some new software, I can change the angle and move the box around and such, and we can do more of these comparisons. And at some point, I wouldn't mind just getting you in front of the software where you can actually start playing with this stuff too.
I would love to do that, and an opportunity might present itself as I'm traveling through. And then afterwards, we'll go storm chasing together. So I did send you some requests because I have this one shot where I'm following a storm in Canton, Texas, and the mesocyclone is cranking and it's got some different tiers in it. And I felt like, man, this might be a good match, but I don't know if it's really the same structure of a supercell. But I'd still like to see it, and I'll put them side by side for any of our other viewers to see what I was thinking and how they differ. I think it'd be cool to see how they differ.
Yeah.
One thing that I want to point out to a lot of people, there's several different kinds of supercells that can drop strong tornadoes. I mean, there's things called mini supercells, which might not drop EF4s or EF5s. I bet there has been one somewhere down the road, but can still drop powerful EF2 you know, EF3 tornadoes. And then also you have the classic, like you got, of that El Reno beast, you know, these massive updrafts. And then you can also have supercells that are really skinny. They almost look like tornadoes just dropping out of a cumulus tower. And those are just glorious to observe.
Sure.
This particular one that I'm talking about dropped a long track EF4. So even that type of supercell looks really different. Imagine over the years of doing more and more simulations, you're going to get all these different kinds of supercells that look really different. Yes. And then that will probably help you zero in on some of the similarities that are causing these long track tornadoes.
Absolutely. Yeah, we're going to be doing more storms in more environments, not just the long track EF5s. We're going to be looking at the tops of the clouds, not just the bottoms. You know, we'll see what happens. We'll just toss it in the pot and make some gumbo and see what comes out.
You know, if you could get a cyclic supercell.
Yep.
And I'm talking about a subset of a subset of a subset, but something like Pilger. And I mean, that's really a crazy, unique scenario. Yeah. Where you've got two long track EF4s on the ground, but having two on the ground might double the chances of seeing some of the features and the currents. How awesome would that be?
That would be so awesome, dude. I have tried to simulate Pilger. We got a sounding that looks like a loaded gun sounding, looks great. And we ran it in the model, and basically it just dies after like a half an hour. The storm goes up and it just, so clearly we have more work to do to understand Pilger. Now, Pilger was especially odd. As you say, it was a subset of a subset of a subset. You had two cyclonic tornadoes. That is weird. That type of storm, and let's also mention 31 May 2013, the big 2.6 mile wide. Those are
fringe cases.
Fringe cases. But sometimes the fringe cases will tell us things that we wouldn't even known to ask about. I have simulated May 31st, but it doesn't produce a 2.6 mile wide EF4, EF5 tornado. But I'm still working on that storm. As you can imagine, these things are complex. You know, the modeling world is far from ideal. And we have far from ideal initial conditions to feed the model in most cases. So the fact that we're able to get something that looks reasonable is really a testament itself. Science can be a whole lot of fun, Hank. We don't know what we're going to discover. That's what makes it so much fun.
Yeah.
As we continue to do these simulations, we're going to have different tornadoes, different situations, and we're just going to unwrap this stuff and see where it takes us.
All right. Well, keep us posted on all your new developments, and thank you again for sitting in with us.
Absolutely, Hank. Take care, and thanks for having me on.